Welcome to the 700 Club. Christy, you heard about this big oil spill?
Crazy, isn't it?
Like a gazillion gallons of oil are now washing up on the shores.
Yeah.
What do you think about offshore drilling now?
It makes me kind of skeptical.
It does?
Absolutely, because with accidents like this, with the amount of damage, it's just incredible.
All right, well, Americans are asking the same question. Are we still going to support offshore drilling?
Now, actually, two new polls give what may be a surprising answer to that very question. Here's Jennifer Wishon with a story.
At the request of Congress and the White House, BP has released this video that shows the public for the first time the toxic mix of oil and natural gas gushing from a broken pipe nearly a mile below the ocean's surface. More than 4 million barrels have escaped. Tar balls are washing ashore. Despite heavy media coverage of the effects of the oil spill, new polls show most Americans still support more drilling for oil off America's coast. In an NBC Wall Street Journal poll, 60% say they support more drilling off the U.S. coast, 34% oppose it. And in an Associated Press poll, 50% of people surveyed support more drilling, 38% oppose it. But no matter what the future holds for oil production in the U.S., Gulf Coast residents are in for a long recovery.
This fan sucks in like this.
As a deep-sea charter boat captain, Eddie Berger can get past fishing bans and keep working, but he's having a hard time getting his clients to bite.
The problem right now is with all the news reports out there, nobody else is calling because they don't think you can go fishing.
Docked boats now crowd marinas along the coast as fishermen wait to see what the future holds.
Their livelihood depends on what really happens in the month May, June, and July. And so if the estuaries are contaminated, the slick becomes a larger issue, a lot of people in South Louisiana are going to lose their livelihood.
I have three boats. It's a lot of investment. They're worthless right now.
It never seems to end. It's one thing after the other. All I could do is go home and pray that something good's going to happen.
Even charitable organizations are at a loss. Since the disaster is man-made, much of the relief effort depends on BP.
This is something that's really not happened before. And so we're in the process of working with BP on how to best provide services to the fishermen. We don't have any secure plans at this point.
BP says it will pay any legitimate claims of damages caused by the spill, even though such payments are supposed to be limited by a federal cap of $75 million. Meanwhile, hearings on Capitol Hill reveal a devastating sequence of equipment failures led to the blowout. However, despite all the problems from the spill, the public seems to believe accidents will happen, but offshore drilling is still worthwhile. Jennifer Wishon, CBN News, Washington.
Well, we're probably going to see more offshore drilling just because we need to reduce our dependence on foreign oil. That's the biggest component of the trade deficit. And if we're going to have any kind of recovery in our economy, we need to try to pare that deficit down. We've just come off a record $80 billion in deficit in the federal government for 1 month, the month of April. We're coming into a record on a trade deficit. We haven't seen that in a couple of years, but it's built back up as the economy recovers and we start buying more. So we've got to reduce that. The only way to do that is to develop more energy sources right here in North America. And I wish policymakers would start looking seriously at liquid natural gas. There seems to be an environmental movement that wants to stop all carbon emissions, and with natural gas, you create carbon. So can we have the political will to do that and overcome that? And at the same time I'm saying this, last night in our U.S. Senate, they introduced a climate change bill to reduce carbon emissions by 17% by 2020. So this is going to be ongoing debate and a big balancing act. How do we get our economy back? How do we get our energy independent of the Middle East? And how do we grow? All of these things are going to happen simultaneously, and the debate is going to go on for years. Lee Webb has the rest of our top stories from the CBN newsroom. Lee?
Gordon, as you mentioned, the federal budget deficit has set yet another record. It hit nearly $83 billion last month. That's a record for the month of April, and it was far above last year's monthly deficit of $20 billion. The Obama administration forecast this year's total deficit will be more than $1.5 trillion. That's also an all-time high. breaking last year's record of $1.4 trillion. Federal spending and debt are expected to be major issues in this year's congressional elections. The number of homes facing foreclosure last month fell 2% from a year ago. It's the first annual decline in 5 years. RealtyTrack says one in every 387 homes received a foreclosure notice last month. That number was down 9% from March. Still, the number of borrowers losing their homes continues to rise. Banks seized a record 92,000 homes last month. Unemployment, one of the main reasons. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is using the Bible to defend the Jewish state's claim to Jerusalem. Reuters reports that Netanyahu told Parliament that Jerusalem's alternative Hebrew name, Zion, appears in the Old Testament 850 times. He then pointed out that Jerusalem is not mentioned in the Muslim holy book, the Quran. Netanyahu also noted that the city is mentioned 142 times in the New Testament. The Israeli parliament was meeting to commemorate Israel's capture of East Jerusalem from Jordan in 1967. Steve Saint is more than a missionary. He's a pilot and inventor, and he's combined those skills to develop new and clever ways to take the love of God to remote parts of the world. Ephraim Graham has that story.
It's a flying dune buggy, an all-terrain vehicle that can drive on freeways or, when needed, take to the skyways.
We've got a rear seat that is wide enough to fit three people across the back. It's also wide enough to have a stretcher.
Popular mechanics called this missionary inventor one of the 10 most brilliant innovators of 2009.
It's hard for people who live in, in a developed world to understand that there are lots of parts of the world that really are beyond roads.
Steve Saint knows what he's talking about. He's the son of martyred missionary pilot Nate Saint. Their story is told in the movie End of the Spear, which relives the deadly attack by jungle natives when Nate and his friends tried to reach them with the gospel.
You know, my dad being a pilot, I've grown up with that gene, but Christ's commission to us was to go to parts of the world where the gospel hasn't reached and where his church doesn't exist, to plant the church. Airplanes are part of the go in missions.
Saint and his team are also developing medical tools.
Trying to figure out ways that we can put frontier people or missionaries who haven't had healthcare background into the driver's seat so they can offer to meet people's felt needs as a way of opening the door to the gospel.
His dental operatory fits in a backpack and includes a solar-powered electrical drill. Saint has trained people on four continents how to fix teeth.
The first course is 10 days, then we follow up with a second course 6 months to a year later. And now we have, in several parts of the world, we have people who had no healthcare background who've become so expert at doing this in frontier areas that they're now training other God followers to be dental techs.
It all comes from the experience Saint himself had living in the Ecuadorian jungle. His goal is to provide his jungle friends and others with tools they can use to share the Christian faith.
To take those tools and reinvent them so that they fit the people in those frontier areas so that they can build the church that mission started.
Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
Amazing. Gordon, the old saying, necessity is the mother of invention.
His father was an inventor and invented a way for a plane to circle, and they dropped buckets down, and that's how they made first contact with some of the tribal groups in Ecuador. And to see his son coming up and doing the same thing. Congratulations to Steve Saint. That is quite an honor to be named by is one of the top inventors in the world. That is incredible, and all in the name of Christ, all in the name of the Great Commission. To go and preach the gospel.
I tell you what, Gord, we can all learn a lesson from that, right? Absolutely. Well, coming up, one man speaks out against terrorism and gets branded as a terrorist himself.
So you've never called for violence or terrorism against the regime?
Never. Even if the Iranian regime changes, we are encouraging people not to seek revenge. We are anti-terrorism.
Find out who's behind this injustice when we return.
Wondering what to give mom that will wow her this Mother's Day? Give something truly unique, hand-dipped gourmet strawberries from Sherry's Berries. Only the biggest berries are hand-selected, hand-dipped, and hand-decorated. They're only $19.99. Order now, and your Mother's Day berries will also come with these premium toppings, plus a personalized card, free. Just go to berries.com. Click on the microphone in the upper right corner. Enter 700 in the box.
They were big and red and fresh, and they were super juicy.
A very elegant gift. Very affordable.
It's easy to use their website. It's easy to select something that looks good.
I love to receive them for Mother's Day.
It's when Mom's happy, everybody's happy.
Or double the berries without doubling the price. It's just $9.99 more. Order right now and get guaranteed delivery by Mother's Day. Go to berries.com. Click on the microphone in the upper right corner. Enter 700 in the box. Or call toll-free 1-888-WOW-1 now and mention TV. Go online now.
Tomorrow, 3 kids in 2 years. See how this woman survived mama mania. And then,
your story's not adding up. You need to tell us something. You need to tell us more than you're telling us.
A confession to a crime.
He'd still be here if it wasn't for me.
One he didn't commit.
I'm gonna spend the rest of my life incarcerated. How am I gonna do it?
Why he says he's guilty. Tomorrow on the 700 Club.
The Iranian regime is notorious for cracking down on dissidents inside Iran. Well, now the government is targeting those who disagree with them in other countries, including right here in the United States of America. And as Eric Stackelback reports, they're using an international organization to do it.
Shahram Humayun fled Iran for the United States 19 years ago. He was a marked man in his native country for supporting democracy and human rights. Now the Iranian regime has finally caught up with Humayun, not in Tehran, but in Los Angeles.
They have managed to keep me here, and it seems like there is nothing the U.S. government can do.
Humayun owns a satellite TV network in L.A. that broadcasts pro-democracy programming into Iran. Iranian officials want to silence him permanently. A prosecutor there recently issued an arrest warrant against Humayun on charges of terrorism.
So you've never called for violence or terrorism against the regime?
Never. Even if the Iranian regime changes, we are encouraging people not to seek revenge. We are anti-terrorism.
Yet Humayun is now a wanted man, unable to leave the U.S. for fear of arrest. The Iranian regime alerted the global law enforcement organization Interpol about Humayun. Interpol then issued what's known as a red notice against him. The red notice alerted all 188 Interpol member countries that Humayun was wanted for terrorism. He told CBN News in an exclusive interview that the terrorist charge has made his life extremely difficult.
I received a notice from my bank in California letting me know about the Interpol arrest warrant. After a few days, they closed my account. This was after 10 years that I had an account with this bank. I wanted to open an account at another local bank, and they turned me down as well because I was on the Interpol list of terrorists.
Humayun says he can't believe the irony of it all. He spends his days in a TV studio speaking out against acts of terror committed by the Iranian regime, which funds groups like Hamas and Hezbollah. Now that same regime is accusing him of terrorism in order to silence him. And Interpol seems to be playing right along.
You have a terrorist regime in Iran. They whack their own dissidents inside the country. They've murdered over 200 opposition people outside the country. And now they're using the International Police Organization to go after those same dissidents.
Iran expert Ken Timmerman says Interpol should have rejected the warrant against Humayun immediately.
Interpol should not be taking the word of the Iranian regime, a terrorist organization, to the bank. They should not be, without any kind of critical examination, accepting arrest warrants from the Iranian regime against people that they can easily verify their activities have nothing to do with terrorism, like Shahram Humayun.
Interpol helps facilitate cooperation and information sharing among law enforcement agencies across the world. It's funded in part by U.S. taxpayer dollars. CBN News contacted the organization's headquarters in Lyon, France. Representatives there tell us Interpol does not get involved in political matters. They would not comment on the Iranian charges against Shahram Humayun, which clearly appear politically motivated.
They have no police authority here in the U.S. They can't come here and make arrests. They don't have any authorities here in the U.S. There's not Interpol agents running around the world making arrests.
Timothy Williams oversees Interpol's U.S. branch in Washington. He says his office works closely with Interpol headquarters in France, but ultimately answers to the Attorney General and the President of the United States.
There's a terrorism lead. We may send it to the FBI here, who will work that lead. If it's a narcotics thing, it may be DEA or the state and local agency. That's how it works here in the U.S.
But critics fear a recent move by the Obama administration could give Interpol greater power inside America and lead to the targeting of U.S. residents like Shahram Humayun. President Obama issued an executive order late last year allowing Interpol to operate on U.S. soil without the usual restraints that apply to domestic law enforcement agencies like the FBI. That means Interpol is not subject to the Freedom of Information Act. Also, its staff and offices at the Department of Justice cannot be searched, and its files cannot be seized.
All that did was give them the same authorities and immunities that any international organization that's based here in the U.S. has. Nothing more, nothing less.
Humayun has his doubts. He believes the Iranian regime is manipulating Interpol to target its enemies in America and Europe, and that the U.S. government should take a stand.
Isn't this an insult to the justice system, the legal system in the United States? Iran has been empowered here in the United States by Interpol.
He plans to challenge the Interpol red notice through legal means and says the FBI has reassured him he'll be safe on U.S. soil. For now, though, he remains on Interpol's international list as a wanted terrorist. Eric Stackelbeck, CBN News, Washington.
Now, this is a story you're not going to see anywhere else. It's an exclusive to CBN News. It's amazing what these international agencies can do, and I also find it amazing that Interpol would allow itself to be used for political purposes to silence dissidents. What this man is doing is operating a satellite channel, speaking a message of hope and democracy to the people of Iran. And the regime doesn't like it and is trying to silence him. You get on these terror lists, you can't do banking, you can't travel. You're on watch lists on any kind of international flight. Appreciate the assurances from our own FBI that you can stay in the United States. You don't have to be afraid. But what's that going to do for his banking? What's that going to do for other things, the other freedoms we all enjoy? So I wish him well in his legal challenge, but the U.S. government has a seat at the table at Interpol and could veto that if they had chosen to. And I would encourage us to choose to do that so that we can be a safe haven, the world can be a safe haven for political dissidents in these kind of regimes. Mm-hmm. Anyway, if you want to know more, we're going to be tracking this story on cbnnews.com. You can go to cbn.com and find the link over to it and get more information on this incredible story.
Absolutely, Gordon. Well, still ahead on the 700 Club, a crook is sentenced to 50 years and doesn't even blink an eye.
I wasn't even caring. I literally didn't care. I would always let people know that I'm in here for killing three people, and I wouldn't have a problem getting a fourth or a fifth or a hundredth.
Let's see what made this hardened criminal soften up later on today's show.
The 700 Club. See it as never before. The stories, the places, the people. The 700 Club, now in HD. We'll take you to India, China, Africa, Thailand, and across the USA. So close, you'll feel as though you were there. Look into the eyes of the people you've helped and see the hope you've given them. Experience what God is doing in the world today in high definition. The 700 Club, now in HD.
Hi, I'm Scott Carter with Goldline. And we're proud to be celebrating our 50th anniversary. By now, most of you have heard how important it is to consider gold as an investment. But with so many options, it's hard to know who to call or where to start. It's important to know the company you work with and ask some key questions before you invest. Like, what's the company's track record? How do they rate in the industry? And how satisfied are their customers? Goldline's been in business since 1960 with a strong, consistent track record. We have more than $500 million in revenue and over 300 employees serving investors. Goldline ranks high from an independent consumer rating service. Let us prove to you why so many satisfied clients choose Goldline for their second, third, and fourth purchases. Call Goldline now and talk with one of our account executives and receive your free investor's kit and the American Advisor newsletter. Make gold part of your future and your family's future. For 50 years, Goldline has been the choice for many investors and people just like you. Call us today.
Jerry Balone spent more than half his life behind bars. While Jerry could handle the long years inside prison, he just didn't know how to handle life out of it.
I was abandoned at birth, left in the hospital. I went through a succession of foster homes, orphanages, detention centers, reform schools.
Jerry Balone moved so often that he never made any friends.
Animals were my only friends. I had no human friends. When I would run away from home, I would usually go sleep in junkyards and crawl in dog houses and sleep with dogs at night to stay warm.
Early on, Jerry gained a reputation as a troublemaker. His rebellion was met with a brutal reality.
If you did something wrong, people would always beat you. When I was in foster homes, I would be beaten. When I was in the orphanages, I wouldn't cry or I wouldn't show any fear. I reached a point where I said, I will never let anybody beat me again.
Jerry's distrust in authority spilled over to his view of God.
Whenever they would mention the word God, I said, I hate God also. If someone mentioned God, I figured that they were hypocrites. I figured that they were soft. I figured that they had an angle.
Once Jerry was a teenager, the crooks and criminals became his role models.
I never felt sorry for any of the people I victimized because I went through life feeling that because when I was younger, I was victimized, that I had a right to victimize others.
In 1973, Jerry and an accomplice broke into a house to steal a valuable stamp and coin collection. The two were surprised to find the owners at home. They stole the collection and murdered the couple on their way out. Before they fled, they shot and killed a neighbor that witnessed the whole event. After police connected him to the crime, Jerry was tried and sentenced 50 years to life in prison.
I wasn't even caring. I literally didn't care. So I got involved in the criminal element in prison, gambling, loan sharking, drug trafficking, and I would always let people know that I'm in here for killing three people, and I wouldn't have a problem getting a fourth or a fifth or a hundredth.
So in 1988, Jerry was transferred with 63 other prisoners to a lockdown unit for problem inmates.
And they said if we had any hopes of ever getting out of that unit, we would have to start taking therapeutic and educational program.
Jerry enrolled in classes with the goal of manipulating the system, but in that process came a surprise.
I went to prison with a fifth grade education. So for me to obtain my GED and find out that I was getting great marks, for the first time in my life, college opened up doors for me. Once I embarked on a journey of education, I never looked back. My associates, my bachelor's, two master's.
Due to a change in laws, Jerry's sentence was knocked down by 25 years. With his new educational resume, Jerry thought he had a chance of parole. On six occasions, he went before a parole board pleading for his freedom, but without success.
I was so frustrated, so angry, that I had done everything that had been required of me, 50 times more than required of me.
Jerry was disappointed, but found hope in a letter from his pen pals, some Dominican nuns. Even though Jerry was agnostic, these nuns became his good friends over the years through their letters.
And the first thing I wanted to do when I didn't make the board is blame God. But the nuns said, well, maybe you need to ask God. And that was the turning point. And I said, Jerry, it's time to try something new.
For the first time, Jerry surrendered his life to Christ and learned about the freedom that comes with forgiveness.
I was still holding on to a lot of pain and anger and bitterness for those people, my mother included, for what had happened to me as a child. The first time was forgiving all of those who had done me wrong. And then they sent me some literature on forgiving myself. It was very, very difficult because I would always go back because I had to reflect on what I had done to my victims. It didn't happen overnight. But I did. I gradually worked it out. And it's like, once I did it, it was like taking a shower after doing a dirty project. It's just like all the dirt came off of me. And it's been, since then, it's just been an amazing journey.
At his next appearance before the board, Jerry was granted parole. Yet freedom brought its own set of challenges. He had spent more than half of his life behind bars, 37 and a half years in 17 different prisons. Finding his place in the free world was difficult.
I never paid a bill ever before in my life. I had to learn how to pay rent, and I didn't know how to do any of these. I never cooked a meal in my life. When I first moved back to this neighborhood, many of my neighbors knew me. They knew my story, and many of them literally were terrified of me moving back.
While Jerry was learning to be independent, his skeptical neighbors started to warm up to this new Jerry.
Right now, all my neighbors know me. When they see me, they wave. I love it. I feel needed, I feel wanted, and for the first time in my life, I'm really giving something back.
Brother Michael Oberst has known Jerry for 9 years and can attest to Jerry's transformation.
My experience of Jerry is that he's very open. I think a real genuineness in his in how he lives, in the integrity he lives in, and his desire to give something back.
Jerry devotes his energy to help former convicts re-enter society. He also warns teenagers about the dangers of crime.
When I go around doing presentations, I always have a mugshot of the night that I was arrested for my crime, and I hold it up for anybody that's in my audience and always say, this is the person that I used to be. I am no longer this person. And I attribute that all to divine intervention. I know God is all forgiving and all knowing and all loving. I'm just so thankful because I know God has a plan for me. He's guiding me to where I need to be. God's been talking to me all my life, but I wasn't listening. Now I'm open.
God's been talking to you all your life, and are you finally ready to listen? Now, Jerry's story is tragic, but at the same time, not unique. Lots of us go through feelings of abandonment. Lots of us in America are growing up without both parents in the home, and you feel like you're being shuttled around. And you're wondering, what's my purpose? What's life? And probably just like Jerry, you're mad at God. You know, why am I here? Why was I ever created? You know, if all this is just going to happen to me, if every home is going to be worse, you don't even think of them as homes. It's just places where you stay. The Bible says that God is the potter. And we're the clay. It also says that when our parents abandon us, He will raise us up. He'll guide us. He'll be reaching out to us. The only issue is, do we recognize that? Now, here's Jerry's story. He went from home to home. He was abandoned in the hospital where he was born. And he just went from home to home to home to reform school, detention center, and then finally jail. Now, given that history, would you ever expect him to do anything, you know, other than stay in institutions? He'd never known love, never known acceptance. All he knew was people wanted to beat him. Never even bothered to think about God. When everybody brought up God, he was just angry. Until finally, he got a letter from a group of nuns. I said, why don't you ask God? Why don't you just try? And in that process, got to get in touch with a lot of feelings of guilt and shame about what he had done. And then he did something unusual. He started writing them down and started realizing what he had done to other people and how it had affected them. And he brought all that to God. And he said it was just like taking a shower after doing a dirty job. It all washed away. And then some really unusual things started to happen to him. He got out of jail. He went back to the same neighborhood he grew up in, and people knew him there. They were initially afraid. But once they got to know the new Jerry, then suddenly he started feeling needed and loved and accepted. And then he started giving back. He started being a voice of wisdom, a mentor to those who were coming out of jail. How can you transition? How can you do what I managed to do? How can you get there? He allowed himself to be shaped by God. God is the potter. We're the clay. And we're a unique form of clay in that we can tell God, leave me alone. Don't try to shape. The good news is he doesn't give up. He keeps trying. And I don't care where you are, if you're in a foster care, a detention center, a reform school, or jail, he hasn't given up on you. Maybe the jail you're in is one of your own making, where you've gotten so deep in habits that you can't see a way out. There is a way out. All you have to do is the same thing Jerry did. Come to terms with what you've done. Write them down. And then bring them to God. God, can you forgive me for this? Can you make me new again? And then just say to him, I'm willing now to be shaped by you. I want you to take control. I want your will to be done, not my will anymore. Your will. When you do that, he'll come in. He'll make you brand new. He'll give you a hope and a future, give you a destiny, put you in relationships that are positive with good people. He does it all because he loves you, because he uniquely created you, and he created you for good works, that you'd have joy and peace and finally find your heart's desire. Now, if this is for you, bow your head with me. Pray a very simple prayer. Do the same thing Jerry did. And you can find the same love that Jerry found. Pray with me. Lord Jesus, that's right, say it out loud. Lord Jesus, I come to you and I ask that you forgive me, that you mold me, that you make me, and make me the way you originally intended. Come into my heart. Let me know that you love me, that you accept me, and that you want me with you. And Jesus, if you'll do this, I promise to follow you all the days of my life. Hear my prayer. For I pray it in Jesus' name. Father, for those who just prayed, I ask for a baptism in love. And I just say over them right now that their sins are forgiven and have been washed away in the blood of the Lamb. Give them the assurance of their salvation, Lord, and speak to them now, for I ask it. In Jesus' name, amen. If you just prayed with me, the Bible says that if you'll believe in your heart and then confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. What I want you to do is go to the phone, make a toll-free call. 1-800-759-0700. Just say, I prayed with that guy on TV. I asked Jesus to come into my heart. We got a free packet for you. In that packet, it's a CD teaching on how to live the Christian life. It's also a booklet. We encourage you to get a copy of the Bible. Start reading it every day and start with the Gospel of John. Do this. Have the renewing of your mind. It's from the washing of the Word. You renew your mind, your whole thought process. You start to think differently. But it starts with that phone call. Make it right now. 1-800-759-0700. We'll be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
Still ahead, Ray Charles's daughter tells about life behind the shades.
Daddy?
Yeah, buddy?
How many nickels are in a dollar?
There are 20 nickels in a dollar.
How do birds fly? Does milk really make my bones stronger?
Yeah.
Daddy, when we die, will we go to heaven?
Do you have the answer to life's biggest question? Call the 700 Club. We'll help you find answers to the important questions life brings your way.
You're stuck on a treadmill. You're making minimum payments on your credit cards, and you just don't get anywhere. Call Consolidated Credit. They'll get the credit card companies to reduce or eliminate your interest. Get off the treadmill. Get on with your life.
Call toll-free 1-800-244-9095.
Consolidated Credit. When credit card debt is the problem, they're the solution.
Welcome back to the 700 Club. The oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico is influencing long-promised legislation to curb global warming. Senate Democrats have unveiled a bill that allows states to veto decisions by other states to drill for oil off their coast. That's if they can show they would be affected significantly by a spill. It also includes a cap-and-trade system that would tax the nation's biggest carbon emitters. The goal is to cut carbon emissions by 17% over the next 10 years. No Senate Republicans support that legislation. Former First Lady Laura Bush disagrees with her husband on same-sex marriage and abortion. During an interview with Larry King, she voiced support for legalizing same-sex marriage. The former First Lady also told Larry King abortion should remain legal, and she told President Bush that on the first day in office. Her comments have those in both parties upset. Liberals believe she should have been more vocal about her stances while they were in the White House. You can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbn.com. Gordon and Christie will be back with more of the 700 Club after this.
I'm often asked the question, is investing in gold right for me? In fact, many people think that owning gold is only for the wealthy, but you can own gold with a minimal investment. It's easy to own gold. At Goldline, our clients invest in physical gold, not gold stocks or gold funds. Call Goldline and talk with an account executive who can answer your questions and discuss the available gold products, like our popular European coins or Proof American coins. Your gold is then shipped directly to you, or we will arrange storage for you. Goldline has been helping investors acquire precious metals since 1960, and we work with new clients every day who have decided that it's time to invest in gold. Isn't it time that you consider gold? I invite you to join the thousands of hardworking, satisfied clients who've chosen Goldline to help diversify by investing in gold. Call Goldline now and receive a free investor's kit and the American Advisor newsletter. Our account executives are here 6 days a week to serve you. Give us a call today.
I was in a lot of pain. I remember feeling, I don't want to have cancer. Why is this happening?
I went to pray with my 10-year-old. He said that he wished he had two hearts because one of them was breaking.
I had to reassure her a lot that I'm going to be okay. Things are going to be all right. You know, God's on our side.
This is one thing that Cancer Treatment Center does for people. They give them the courage and the strength to battle cancer.
When you first walk in that building, you almost feel like there's the presence of the Holy Spirit.
It is about the patient. It is only about the patient and what is it that they need and what do they want.
Call now and we'll send you this free DVD that shows you how our very special team of experts and caregivers put you at the center of everything we do. Hope is alive at Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
I don't really see how anyone can get through a life-threatening disease without the Lord in their life. He gives us the strength that we need to carry on.
I want to show you how your gifts helped a young mother in China. When Tsai Yun found out she was pregnant, she was overjoyed, but she was also very afraid, and you're about to see why.
The closer Tsai Yun got to her baby's due date, the more worried she became.
I was afraid that my baby would be born with a cleft lip, like I was. I have heard that they can be passed down in the genes.
Tsai Yun has since had surgery, but she remembers the years of pain her cleft lip and palate caused her.
People used to always stare at me. All the criticism and the looks made me feel crazy inside.
So she decided to do everything she could to prevent the same thing from happening to her child.
I put all my faith into Kuan Yin. I prayed to this idol and asked that she would keep my baby from having a cleft lip.
But Tsai Yun's baby was born with a cleft lip, and she and her husband Jin couldn't afford surgery. Jin Hu works in construction and makes very little money. Still, he was willing to do anything to help Xu Ran.
I told my friends that I would sell all my possessions in hopes that we could get surgery for our baby girl.
As hard as the couple tried, they couldn't sell or save enough. It looked like Xu Ran would be ridiculed for life.
I felt so guilty about my baby and her cleft lip.
Then a friend told the Hus about CBN. And CBN provided free surgery for Xu Ran.
I could not have been any happier. The moment my baby came out of surgery, I couldn't help but cry because my baby's cleft lip had been fixed and she looked much, much better than ever.
I'm so grateful to CBN for how boundless your love is. It inspires people to help the poor.
I want to thank you. When I look back, I realize that idol worship did not do me any good. It is not real, but CBN's help is. What a difference you have made in my daughter's life.
If you're a member of the 700 Club, I want to thank you for that. Your gifts made it possible to give that child a smile. If you're not a member, I'd like to join with us, all you have to do is call the number on the screen, 1-800-759-0700. How much is it to be a member? Just $20 a month, 65 cents a day. And you join with tens of thousands of people that want to make a difference, want to bring smiles to children in China, want to drill water wells for villages in India, do medical missions in Indonesia and Latin America. Want to be a part of everything we're doing. All you have to do is join the 700 Club. 1-800-759-0700, or you can log on to CBN.com. When you join, I encourage you to ask for Pledge Express. Automatic monthly giving. You don't have to worry that your gift is coming in. It's going to be automatic. Your bank handles all the work, aren't any checks or stamps or anything to mail. We save so much on the processing we can send as our gift back to you. Power for Life, monthly teaching CDs. So if you want it, ask for Pledge Express. Well, it's time for some bringing on questions, and we're going to turn the tables on Christy and ask her. So she's going to be the expert today. Here we go. My kids are in elementary school and love to play with the kids next door. The neighborhood kids are ignored by their parents or poorly behaved, and I don't want my kids to pick up their bad habits. Do I expose my kids to this or protect them from it?
You know, I think as parents, Gordon, so oftentimes we want to protect our kids and shield them. And in the process of doing that, we're not really showing the love of the Lord to those kids. If those kids are obviously neglected and they're behaving poorly, it's because there's no one there to kind of teach them how not to behave, you know, how to behave wonderfully. So I would embrace those kids. If they're going to play with your kids, say, come on, let's play together. And when they do kind of behave badly, you know, it's the art of distraction. I love the art of distraction and say, you know, maybe they're doing something. You can say, well, what do you need? What do you want? And just to kind of love them. And it's interesting.
So you bring them into your home.
I wouldn't bring them into my home, but I would bring them, well, because I don't bring kids into my home, but I would bring, like, for instance, I'll give you a perfect example. Not too long ago.
Yeah. Write her on that.
No.
One.
Not too long ago, my
Bring
son was outside. Oh, well, yeah, but you've got to, anyway.
You got to provide snacks and all that kind of
stuff. Well, yeah, I do that. But, like, not too long ago, my son was out, and there were these new kids that were around the neighborhood. And so they were just kind of, like, walking the street, and I would just see them walking. And I said, well, why don't you come over and play? I said, Chase, why don't you ask them? So they all start playing. So I went inside, and I got bubbles, and I got candy, and I got all this stuff, and water balloons. And
candy?
I played with them. Yeah, candy.
It's not allowed on Skinny Wednesday.
It ain't Wednesday. It's Thursday. But in the process, now it's funny.
To their parents, now you're giving them candy.
They're happy. So now the kids always come and ring the doorbell because you showed them the love.
Okay.
Did I answer the question?
You did.
All right, good.
You did. Show the love.
Show the love.
Yeah, that would be the, yeah.
Okay.
I'd check that one, go, yeah.
I think that's good. Okay, now it's your turn.
All right, my turn.
You ready? Cheryl Lynn writes in, she says, I made a new friend at a community college where I attend. He's a Buddhist and says he would like to learn more about Christian beliefs. I invited him to come to church with me, but he says he's only going to come and agree to go if I go to his temple. What do you think?
Wow. Well, you get the kid question, I get the Buddhist question.
I know, right?
I myself have gone to Buddhist temples in an effort to learn more about Buddhism because... I was tasked with trying to evangelize parts of the Buddhist world, Thailand and Vietnam and China and Burma, and I wanted to learn about it. It wasn't with a specific individual. When I started telling other Christians I was doing that, I learned about Hinduism, learned about Islam, all because I just really felt it was a call. And I found evidence where the Apostle Paul had tried to learn. He was raised Jewish, and he was trying to learn the local religions of the cities that he was evangelizing. And he even talks about going around and considering their objects of worship in Acts chapter 17. So I took that as inspiration and did that. And learned a fair amount. Now, when I talked to other Christians about it, they were going, oh, no, your mind's been polluted by these other thoughts. And I'm going, no, it's not. The more I found out, the more grateful I was for the message of the gospel, because I learned something real critical, and that all these other religions, I don't care which ones you name, it's all about how can you perfect yourself? Mm-hmm. How can you get to a point where you can finally come into nirvana or moksha or... have entry into heaven, and it's all about that. And with that comes this whole slavery to it, where if you don't bow down to the idol and you don't offer sacrifice, then the demons are going to come and get you. But here was Christianity, and Christianity said, God's going to do all that for you. God's going to come down from heaven. You don't have to make yourself perfect to get to heaven. He's going to come down to you right where you are, and he's going to be with you. And he's never going to leave you or forsake you. He's going to forgive everything you've ever done wrong because he loves you so much. And it's the love of God that brings us to repentance. With the Buddhists, their first noble truth is all existence is suffering. Life is suffering. That's the first thing they teach people. And I just scratch my head and go, no, life is wonderful. And when you hear the words of Jesus, I came that you might have life and have it more abundantly. The contrast will be obvious, but get yourself geared up. And but I encourage you get to know these others, and in that whole process, you'll become very grateful for what Jesus Christ did.
Good answer, and you didn't even need my help. I'm kidding, Gordon. I'm kidding. Listen, if you want to ask Gordon even more questions, remember, you can always log on to CBN.com.
Or Christy.
Log on to CBN.com, and it's a great place where CBN.com is awesome anyways, but you can always check out some more Bring It On questions. Anyway, coming up, as a kid, Sheila didn't know her father. Well, today, she carries his name. Meet Sheila Ray Charles later on today's 700 Club.
You and I are ordinary people. Ordinary people who are capable of affecting the world in extraordinary ways. Come to Regent University. When you earn your degree from Regent, you become a vital part of the mission we all share. Christian leadership to change the world.
For a free welcome kit, visit lead.regent.edu or call 866-REGENT-U.
If you love fresh garden tomatoes but hate digging, bending, and weeding, then get off the ground and grow your tomatoes upside down with the Topsy-Turvy Tomato Planter. Only the original Topsy-Turvy has our patented grow bag technology. The sun warms the planter like a greenhouse, so the root system explodes, giving you up to 30 pounds of delicious garden tomatoes with no digging or weeding. Perfect for small yards, patios, even your porch. So grow your tomatoes the easy way and get your Topsy-Turvy today.
Welcome back to the 700 Club. Well, in 2008, Rolling Stone magazine placed Ray Charles at the number two spot on its 100 Greatest Singers list. Well, Charles had a memorable career that was nearly derailed by a drug addiction. And that same can actually be said about his very own daughter, Sheila.
Sheila Ray Charles is the daughter of the legendary Ray Charles. Music wasn't the only thing she inherited from her father. She also battled a life of drugs with a 20-year crack addiction. Unlike her father, Sheila was jailed in federal prison three times. But behind prison bars is where she found her freedom. Today, Sheila shares how she learned to forgive her absentee father and put her troubled past behind her.
Please welcome to the 700 Club singer Sheila Ray Charles. What a name to carry.
Thank you,
Christy. Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, you know what? Talking about what God will do to change your life. And when the Lord told me that he would turn my life around and then I would go around the world and talk about his goodness, I fought it the whole way, Christy. I was like, oh, you're not going to make me go around and talk about my dirt.
Yeah.
But the Lord revealed to me that it is about his glory. Mm. It is about letting somebody know that there is no depth of hell that he can't reach down and pull you out of.
Exactly.
And I'm telling you, he reached down to a real deep one in my circumstances.
Well, let's talk about that. Let's talk about that. You were one of 12 children that Ray Charles had.
Yes.
But what's interesting is that you never actually met your dad until you were about 14 years old.
Absolutely. For whatever reason, my mother and my father always had a relationship after I was born. And my father had a wayward relationship with all of us kids. And I didn't understand what that was about. But finally, I was actually about 12 years old because I wanted to go back out to California and resume my career at Marie Szilard Academy, being the youngest student ever accepted there. And I said, well, Mom, while I'm there, you know, I'd like to meet my dad. I've talked to him on the phone all of my life, but I have no personal relationship with him. And so my mother set it up, and we talked on the phone, and it was really strange because I was so excited to get out there and speak with him. And when I got there, I had to make an appointment. So
wow.
It was like, you know, that is like it busts your whole bubble because I'm thinking, oh, we're going to go walking down Disneyland and hold hands and get on the rides. And, you know, that was my thought of who my father would be to me because we hadn't seen each other. So it was kind of disheartening.
Yeah. You know, you kind of suffered a lot with just rejection and a lot of just very difficult things in your childhood. Can you just kind of give me a very brief summation?
Well, as a young child, I went through many different things, from child abuse to physical abuse. My mother, who was an awesome woman of God, had an alcoholic problem. And so I had two parents that were addicts and didn't understanding the spiritual ramifications of what that would have in my life until later on. But went through a lot of pain in trying to find out and figure out who I was. You know, the world knew Ray Charles. And so I was always introduced as, this is Sheila Ray Charles. This is Ray Charles's daughter. Or this was never this, this is Sheila. So in order for me to find my identity, I created people. I made up things in my life that I would pretend that I was. And so ultimately what ended up happening is I created such a lie, for lack of a better word. My life became such a terrible lie that I found my way in spiraling in this incredible drug addiction that I couldn't find my way out of.
Exactly. And because of that drug addiction, almost a 20-year drug addiction, that kind of landed you in prison, what, three different times?
Federal prison three different times. And, you know, I always say that there's something about that number three in God, because it was the third time that I was in prison that I was able to find, come back to my true self, which was in Christ.
Well, let's talk about that. Yes. You know, I believe that everybody has that pivotal moment where they really realize that Jesus Christ is real. Absolutely. Now, whether it's a time when you hit rock bottom or just a revelation, what was it for you that you said, this isn't the life I want?
Oh, Christy. Well, what happened is it was about 3 a.m. in the morning and I had fallen off my bunk and I was lying on the floor and I began to weep. And it was such a cry that I can't really describe to you the pain and the suffering that had culminated. It all had came to a head. And I knew that my life as it was could never exist anymore. Death was more becoming than continuing in the lifestyle that I was living. And I looked up, Christy, at the ceiling and I cried out and I said, God, or whatever you are, whatever spiritual thing you are, they tell me you're the author of life and death. And if you have that much control, then take me from this planet right now, because if I have to live a life where I have 5 children, I've lost custody of every single one of them. I have 3 crack cocaine addicted children. I have a son that was born so premature you could see through his skin. He had a hole in his heart and he would stop breathing every 5 minutes. And I was stuck in the hospital room across from him, smoking crack, waiting for the dope man to come. Mm-hmm. I had to snatch my hand from my mother who was dying of lung cancer that went to her brain. Mm-hmm. These things, I cried out and I said, if I have to continue in this lifestyle, yes, living like this, I can't do this. Mm-hmm. And God did something supernatural at that moment.
And he changed your life. And now today, you're singing about how God has changed your life and how you have become brand new. Well, listen, we could keep going and going and going and going and going, because you know TV just flies, but I want to release you. I want you to sing.
Thank you.
So you head on over there, and as you head over there to sing this song, I want to just tell our audience that Sheila Ray's latest CD, it is called... What is it called? It is be called Behind the Shades. You can find a copy of it all by logging on to CBN.com. Well, right now, here she is singing the song, Behind the Shades.
I'm Terry Newson. I've had the privilege of traveling all around the world and seeing firsthand the difference you're making through your partnership.
In Turkey, CBN partners are caring for orphans and teaching them computer skills so they can find good jobs when they become adults. In Haiti, you are there bringing much-needed medicine, clean water, and food to help the Haitian people through this disaster. All around the world, you bring the hope of Jesus Christ to people who have nowhere to turn. Just like you did for Dilcia, this little girl's cough turned into pneumonia, but her parents couldn't afford medicine. That's when you brought a medical clinic to their village and gave Dilcia the treatment that saved her life. Your monthly gift makes it possible to care for victims of disaster, feed the hungry, preach the gospel, and so much more. Please watch for this mailing and send in your pledge.
Imagine giving someone hope for a better future. You do that every day, and it only happens because you were there.